Next slide, I will do a short presentation about me. But today we are going to let's learn or make a presentation about URL filtering on USG firewalls. Why we choose this topic? When Elena approached me to make this webinar, I was thinking what would be a very interesting topic for the firewalls. And in my opinion, the most interesting topics are either about the IPsec or maybe the SSL VPN, but also the URL filtering, which I find very interesting from my point of view. And this topic has always had open questions for the customers. So it's not very clear. So it's not very understandable. You need to deep a little bit deeper to understand it. So I that's why I choose this topic, because I find it very interesting. I hope you will find it also too, and every of your questions will be clear after this presentation. Okay, my name is Catalin Pacurariu. I have more than 10 years experience in the ICT sector. I started working in companies first. My first workplace was Alcatel-Lucent, then I also Wipro and Nokia. I joined Huawei in 2016 when I started working as a CSE for the Datacom product line. 2017, I was promoted as a PSE for the security products, but also as a local team leader. Since 2019, I worked full-time as a team leader and later as a business leader for the Datacom product line. Even now I'm disconnected from the engineering job, Datacom products are still my passion. And I mean disconnected that I don't work directly with the customers like before, and I don't do troubleshooting now, but I'm still connected to all the problems that appear in customers' networks even now. Okay. What will you learn in this webinar? First of all is understanding the URL filtering principles. How, why do we need URL filtering and how does it work? Then we how to configure URL filtering, and I will show you an example on a lab firewall, how to apply the URL filtering and how to configure it after some examples, or when you want to achieve something, how to configure the policies. And then some master URL filtering troubleshooting methods and some FAQs about URL filtering, the most asked questions of customers when it comes to this topic. Okay, first we will start with the theoretical part. Then we will configure an example on a lab device. Then we will have a live Q&A session. You can also post anytime your questions in the chat, and I from time to time I will check it and reply to them. And then we will have the Q&A session on the forum. Okay, let's start with the URL filtering principle. Why do we need URL filtering, right? This is the main question. First of all, like I always say, the firewall is the device that is always at the edge of the edge of the network. Like here in the picture, you have the enterprise, and the firewall is the device that connects the LAN with the internet. So all the traffic from the enterprise goes through the firewall and out on the internet. The firewall, or at least, but I think all the firewalls from all the providers, but also the USG firewall is not only a firewall. That's why it's called USG, is a unified security gateway. So basically, this is not only a firewall, it's a security gateway that has all the security features in one device. The firewall has the basic feature of packet filtering, denying on permitting packets from one destination to another based on the quintuple or seven-tuple, right? Source IP, destination IP, source port, destination port, application, and also can filter on based on users. but also the other security features like content security features, like antivirus. It can scan the content, like URL filtering, like IPS IDS features. It's a SSL VPN gateway when the remote users, employees from home, can connect via an SSL VPN, can connect to the enterprise and work remotely. It can be a hub for the, or a termination point for IPsec tunnels. It has anti-DDoS features, right? So the USG, the firewall, the USG is an all-in-one security device. Of course, we will have also security device that have only one feature. If we are a data center and we need to protect our servers from the attacks, anti-DDoS attacks, we will buy an anti-DDoS device that is specialized and has high performance for this kind of features. But if you want an all-in-one device, the USG is perfect for this. So why we need to apply the URL filtering? So when the employees are working, we all know that we in our free time or during our work, we try to surf the web, right? And we lose precious time doing this, visiting, I don't know, gaming websites or gambling websites. I know that most of the employees do that. We want to avoid such things and deny the access to such websites of the employees, because this will severely reduce the employees' productivity. The next point is waste of enterprise network bandwidth resources. We know that web browsing, or let's say YouTube, will consume a lot of bandwidth, right? And most of the time at home, the bandwidth is not a problem, especially here in Romania. We all have enough bandwidth to do everything we want. But in an enterprise, the bandwidth, we pay for the bandwidth. We have probably leased lines, which are very which are limited. The bandwidth is limited and cost a lot of money. And that's why we don't want that the employees waste bandwidth by visiting websites and browsing, but we should use the bandwidth for important services. Then the employees can introduce viruses and Trojan horses from malicious sites to the intranet. We don't know what websites will the employees surf. They can download something from that website, and of course, virus. They can get a virus on their PC or a Trojan horse and some ransomware or something like this. We want to avoid this. And there can be legal risks such as copywriting, politics, when surfing some website. So, like here in the examples, we have the employees in the enterprise. We have the firewall, and let's say we want to deny the employees to visit websites that contain sexual content, violent websites, business websites, shopping websites, news websites. And we want to allow, let's say, like here in the example, only to connect to the business websites or to some other categories of websites. We can do this by using URL filtering on the firewall. What is the principle of URL filtering? So first, we have the employees, we have the firewall, we have the internet, and we have the servers on the internet. Let's say employee A wants to access www.game.com, HTTP website. We know that HTTP uses at a transport layer TCP, right? But because it uses TCP, we have the three-way handshake, right? Which will be established. The three-way handshake will be established, and then we will have the HTTP protocol. Basically, when the employee types www.game.com, we have the TCP connection established, and then the PC will send the HTTP GET message with the URL at the server, right? At the game.com server. The firewall then will intercept the HTTP GET message and checked whether the request is valid. Basically, it will check the URL or the URI in the GET message, and we say, is this website, does this website allow, or should I allow to pass this GET message to this website or not? If the request is valid, the request is allowed and the user can browse the corresponding website. It will go to the server, the HTTP GET will go to the server, and the employee can download the resources from that URL, the URL that he wanted to connect to. If the request is invalid, because maybe this is a gaming website, right? We shall assume. And we blocked all the access to the category of gaming websites. We don't want to allow employees to visit the gaming website. In that moment, the firewall will check, will see that game.com belongs to the gaming category. It will see that it's in an invalid request. Basically, what it will do? It will push an alarm back to the user, right? With saying that the resource that he wants to connect to is not allowed by a security policy or whatever. You can customize the message that you will get in reply. And of course, the firewall will reset the TCP connection, right? So by using HTTP, you will also get a notification. I think you already, at least when I wanted to visit some website from the intranet, from the Huawei intranet, I get this message that you cannot connect to this website, and you get the message. You can customize the message that, or the web page that the customer will receive if he tries to connect to a website that is not allowed to. So it's quite simple. The firewall will basically check the HTTP GET message and will allow or deny the access to this content. Okay, what is an URL and what is the structure? If each web page on the internet has a unique identifier, right, like a name, because we are used to names and not to IP addresses, so it will be hard for us to visit or to remember IPs numbers. It's very easy for us as humans to remember names. So that's why we introduced all the resources are found under names. But actually, behind those names, there is an IP address. So each website on the internet has unique identifier called the Uniform Resource Locator, URL address. What is the structure of the URL address? First, we have the protocol, which are used to connect to this address, HTTP or HTTPS for the websites. Then we have the host name or the domain name, right? Which here is www.abcd.com. Then we have the port that we use to connect to this host name, which for usually the well-known ports are 80 for HTTP and 443 for HTTPS. But actually you can use any port. You can configure the server to respond to any port you would like or you want. Then we have the path, which here is /news/education and extension .aspx. And then we have the parameter part. Okay. So this is the structure of an URL address. Okay, what are the matching modes of the URL? So first of all, we can match we can do prefix matching, right? We can use the asterisks, like we have www.huawei.com. Asterisks, and then match all the URLs starting with www.huawei.com. For example, www.huawei.com, and also www.huawei.com/solutions. Right. So everything that has this prefix will be matched. If this, in case you want to use the blacklist or whitelist, which we will talk later, then we will have the suffix matching, which is asterisk ASPF, for example, matches all the URLs ending with ASPX, for example, www.huawei.com/news/solution.aspx. and www.huawei.com/it/price.spx to control the access to all image web pages at www.example.com. Configure URL filtering rules as JPG, JPEG, GIF, PNG, and BMP. So basically the extension. Then we can do keyword matching. It's Huawei.com between two asterisks and matches all the URLs containing Huawei.com. So it doesn't matter what suffixes we have, what other parameters we have at the end. If it has the keyword Huawei.com, it will match to any URL. And of course, we have the exact match where we have www.huawei.com/news, and this will match only to www.huawei.com/news. So if we have /news/solutions.aspx, this will not match to this URL. So the URL must be exactly like the one we used for the match. Okay, what are the filtering modes that the firewall can do, or what filtering modes can we use? First of all, we have the blacklist on the and the whitelist. On the blacklist and on the whitelist, we are the ones that say which URLs should be blocked or allowed using this kind of matching. Either prefix matching, either suffix matching, keyword matching, or exact matching. So we can put URLs in a blacklist or in a whitelist. Then we have the user-defined URL categories. We can define some categories by ourselves. Let's say we have a list of URLs and we make a category websites used for work, right? A category made by us. And we put all the list, we know which are the URLs that our employees need to be to able to connect to, right? To do their jobs, to daily jobs. We make a user-defined URL category, URLs needed for job, and we make a list with all these URLs. And then we have a user-defined URL category. And of course, the predefined URL category, which are populated, let's say, by the Huawei, and has all the URLs or almost all the URLs that exist on the internet are put in one some categories. And we have categories like news, politics, pornography, crime, and so on. And all these categories are populated with all the URLs on the internet. This is a service done by Huawei, and every day these categories are being updated. If you find the URL that doesn't belong to the right category or doesn't belong to any category, you can signal us on sec.huawei.com webpage, on our security webpage, and our colleagues will change it according to the right category, or will put it in one of the categories. So these predefined URL categories are updated on a daily basis by our Huawei staff. And I think the predefined URL categories for filtering is the most common way of using, is the best way of using to filter the URLs based on category. Users can create multiple URL policies based on the URL defined or predefined categories. So for the different users, we have the sales department, we have the R&D department, we have the engineer department, and so on. For each of these departments, you can create a URL policy and we can do some actions. For example, for the sales department, we can allow sporting, action is blocked. Competition is allowed, search engines should be allowed, gaming should be blocked, news should be blocked, politicians should be allowed, porn should be blocked, violence should be blocked. For the R&D department, we can use another URL policy where we allow and block some other categories. So for each kind of users or users group, we can define some other URL policies and allow and block some other categories based on our needs. So no problem about this. Okay, in the implementation of the process of the URL category filtering. So we have the category name. Basically, we have the description for this. We put an action, we make URL policy, and the URL policy will be put in a security policy. The security policy needs to identify the traffic, right, and allow it, because you can put it only in the security policy that allows the traffic, because I will show you, we have the security policy that allows the traffic, and then we will apply the URL policy on the traffic that is allowed by the security policy. So first of all, we need the security policy to identify the traffic on which we apply the URL policy, which will allow this kind of traffic. And after the traffic is allowed by the URL, by the security policy, the URL policy will be applied. And of course, in the security policy, we have a lot of parameters like users, time range, when this security policy should be active or not. Okay, what is the URL filtering process? What is the URL filtering process? As you can see, in the matching process, the firewall has a lot of steps which it needs to to verify. So we have the start. We have the get message, right? And first of all, what the firewall will do, will check if the HTTP packet is normal or not normal. If it's a normal HTTP packet, it will go to the other step. If it yes, it will be denied. So the firewall will not let abnormal HTTP requests get on the internet or to the resource. Does the URL match the whitelist? Yes, if the URL matches the whitelist, the traffic will be permitted, right? The access to this URL, it will be permitted. If it's not matching the whitelist, it will go down. Of course, if it will go to the other step. So see, the most important step in this process is the whitelist. It's the whitelist has the most, let's say, power or the highest precedence. So if a URL is if it's in a whitelist, it doesn't matter the other steps. The access to this URL will be permitted. Then, does the URL match the blacklist? If it matches the blacklist, the traffic will be denied. If it no, it will go to the other step. Does the refer match the whitelist? If the referrer match the whitelist, then the traffic is it be permitted. If it no, if it doesn't match the whitelist, it will go to the other step. What is referrer? When you send an HTTP GET message, in the HTTP message, there is a field name referrer. Referrer is usually used when, let's say, we visit a website, and from that website we click on the URL, but from that website that will redirect us to some other resources. When we click from that website on that URL, in the HTTP GET message, we will have the referrer, which is the first website that we visited. So if the referrer is in a if the referrer of the HTTP GET message will match the whitelist, then the traffic will be permitted. Is the user-defined URL category matched? If we have a user-defined category and it will match, it will do the action that we have configured in the user-defined category. If we don't have a user-defined category, it will examine the dynamic malicious URL list. So we can configure on the firewall a URL list with the malicious URLs. And if it will match this list, the traffic will be denied. If it doesn't match this list, it's another step of malicious URLs or low reputation URL matching. This is again a signature database that is updated every time with the low reputation URLs. And if it will match such URL from this list, of course the traffic to that URL will be denied. Of course, a website can also get on this malicious URL list. If, for example, the firewall can put it automatically there. If you visit a website, you download something from there, and the firewall will detect a virus, right, in the attachment or in the download. It will automatically put that URL in the malicious URL list, right? So if some other users will visit that website, the traffic will be denied to that website because we already visited that URL. Some user downloaded something, it was a virus, and the firewall automatically put it in there, in the malicious URL list. Then it's a predefined URL category in the catch is matched. We will do the action for the predefined URL category. Is the remote query server available? If the remote query server is not available, then it will do the default action, what we set up for the remote, when the remote query server is not available. Does the remote server, does the remote query timeout? If it yes, it will do the action for the remote query timeout. It will, if no, the process, the request based on the action that that the predefined category returns from the remote query server. And then this is the end. So let's do a little recap. So you will see the URLs that are in the whitelist have the most impact. So if you put a firewall URL in the whitelist, it will be allowed. Then we will have the blacklist. Then we will have the user-defined categories. Then we will have the predefined categories. So let's get back to this slide. So it's like this: whitelist, blacklist, then user-defined, and then predefined. This is the order in which the firewall will check if it should allow or what action should we do, should the firewall do when we got an URL. What is the remote category server? Remote query server. Imagine on the internet you have millions or tens of millions of URLs. The firewall cannot remember and has not enough place to remember all the categories with all the categories on this world. So for this, you need to pay a subscription, and the firewall will connect will have a live connection with our Huawei remote category server. Sorry. In case a user visits a URL, And this URL, the firewall doesn't know to which category this URL belongs to, it will do a query to the remote category server. And the remote category server will return an answer. Let's say I will do a visit to Huawei.com. The firewall is a new firewall. He doesn't know to which category Huawei.com belongs to. Okay, it will query the remote category server. The remote category server will reply, Huawei.com belongs to the technology category. And then the firewall will do the action according to the predefined, what should he do for the technology category? Permit or deny the traffic. Of course, if another user will visit Huawei.com, the firewall will keep this in his memory that Huawei belongs to this to this category. But of course, the flash or the it cannot store all the websites, right? And when the available space for this for the URL categories is full, it will the firewall will delete the least used, right? And will keep the most used URLs and the categories. And like I mentioned, first, do I have the category, this URL category on my database, on my local database? Yes, I will do the action according to this. No, I don't know to which, if I don't have it. Okay, I will query the URL category server and wait for an answer for it to give me the category to which this URL belongs to. Okay, but now here is my question. I talked here about HTTP, right? But HTTPS is encrypted. How can we filter HTTP websites? Can we do this? One second, let me see if I have. Some questions for you from you. Sorry, I cannot find. Where is the chat?
It's right here in the middle, and if you click on it, it will show in the right.
Got it. Okay, let's look. Yes, URL filtering and application filtering is very interesting. Okay. How does the firewall recognize that the specific URL links to a gaming category? For example, if the URL hostname was very strange. It's like I mentioned, because the firewall is all, if you buy a license for this, the firewall is always connected to the category server. And if the firewall doesn't have the doesn't know that this URL belongs to a gaming category, it will query the server. Of course, if the server doesn't have an answer for this, when you configure the URL filtering, you can configure the action. What should we do if we don't have an answer? If you don't know to which this URL, to which category it belongs, and then you can configure. Okay. I asked the URL category server. He doesn't know to which category this URL belongs to. What should my default action be? Allow the connection to this URL or not? So you can configure this. But of course, the database is huge. So I don't think you will find, or there can be situations where the URL is not updated in our database. And like I mentioned, you can go on the website, sec.huawei.com, and write to our colleagues and say, this URL doesn't belong to any category, and they will make sure that in a few days they will put the URL in a category. Or also, we had customer complaints that this category this URL belongs to a wrong category. And of course, we got on the website, we wrote to our colleagues, and they changed the category of that URL. Firewall vendors will have their own database. All engineers will work on the database and keep it. Yes, we will try to keep the database updated, but it's not a local database on the firewall because it will be very huge. We have the local database that is populated real time when the users try to connect to different URLs, but when it's full, it's full, and of course it will keep only the entries that are the most used. And of course, for the new entries, it will query the URL category server on live. Excuse me, could you please repeat user-defined and predefined categories? Yes, I will. I think you can understand better when I will show you on the live firewall. The predefined categories are the categories which the firewall has by default, like gaming category, politics category, and so on. And the user defined are the categories that you can do. I can do a user defined category, like I gave you the example, URLs you need that we need for work, right? This is a category predefined by me. And in that category, I can put any URL I want, a list of, I don't know, 100, 200 URLs that are needed for work. And this is a user-defined category, which is a category that I invented, let's say like this. And the predefined are the categories that are used by Huawei and are the categories that come with the firewall. How filtration can be done based on content in a web page? I don't want to display any image or content belong to gaming or pornography. And how we can block URL which are accessed by any proxy application or website. For the second question, doesn't matter if you access by proxy, because the firewall is before the proxy. And I will show you how it will be blocked, or what will we check in the message to block it, and how to filter, filtration can be done based on the content in a web page. We can do content filtering. This is another topic. But I don't want to display any image or content belonging to gaming or pornography. I'm not sure that you can do this. I don't want to display any image or content belonging to gaming. So I'm not sure you can do this, because if you allow to go on that particular website, but it has some gaming content, I'm not sure you can block this. It would be too difficult. So I don't think you can do this. What is the referrer? The referrer, I show you what is the referrer. 1 second. You see the capture, right? Yes. So we have the three-way handshake, right? SYN, SYN ACK, and ACK. And then we have the HTTP GET message. And this is the referrer here. So it's another URL. Basically, usually I cannot explain you, because I don't know the HTTP protocol very well, but basically, so it's another URL. So basically, if we go on this website, and this website, we click on a URL from this website, so usually, this is how I understand that the referrer works when you set up a server. You go on that URL on the server, and the server redirects you to some other URLs. So the referrer will be the URL that you visited before the redirection. Something like this, it works. So you have also the referrer field here in the HTTP GET message. Is the main website that directed? Yes, is the main website that directed you to the to another URL? Yes. How some firewalls have the option called safe search. If you enable that, all these images won't show. Yes, I don't know how to configure this on URL on the USG firewall. Sorry, I need to search this. I don't think we have such an option. How do we access the firewall device? I will show you how to access the firewall device. We go immediately to the lab. Please, if you can explain the relationship between proxy and the web page. The proxy and the web page. Yes, I will explain you. I think the best explanation would be now if I explain you how the firewall can work as a proxy for the HTTP. And I think you can understand exactly what the proxy does. And then we can speak up more if you have some other questions. Okay, let's get back to the presentation because now we got to the part where I will show you how the HTTPS, how we filter HTTP web pages. Okay, 1 second from current slide. Okay, so how do we filter HTTPS content? Because this is encrypted, right? I've talked only about the HTTP. Not about the HTTPS. For HTTP, it's very simple. Okay, there are two methods. The firewall, we have two methods. First, by extracting the fields containing URL information from the SSL handshake, right? And the second, configuring SSL decryption on the firewall, where the firewall will work as a proxy device. And this will answer your question. Okay, we know that because the HTTPS uses SSL, we have the SSL handshake, right? The client hello, the server hello, the exchange of the certificate, right? And then the exchange of the keys. This is the first method. The principle of Huawei firewall's URL filtering is to extract the fields containing URL information for the SSL handshake packets from the client hello and the certificate packets. The three fields are as follows. The SNY, server name identification, CN, common name, and SAN, SAN, subject alternative name. Output, the extracted URL information to the URL module for detection and perform subsequent action according to the detection result. So, for the in the SSL handshake, the first is the client hello. In the client hello, we have a field called server name, right? Here in this example, the user wanted to, we use TLS 1.2, and the user wanted to visit google.com. In the client hello, we have the server name SNY, which is google.com. We extract this field from here. The second message is the server hello, and then the server will send the server certificate. In the server certificate, we have the common name. This is the certificate, which is in all the fields are in clear text. And we have the common name, which is www.google.com, right? And then also in the certificate, we have the DNS name, which is the SAN, subject alternative name, which is the DNS name, which is also google.com. So see, we extract all the information about the URL that the user wants to visit before the information is encrypted. So if for the here, the HTTP GET message will be already encrypted. So we cannot use the extracting the URL from the HTTP GET message because it's already encrypted. But we have some other means of identifying what URL he wants to visit by basically by intercepting the client hello and the certificate, the server certificate, and extracting some information from there. The second part is SSL decryption. And here the firewall works as a proxy, right? Exactly your question. Why does the firewall needs to work as a proxy? Because he needs to decrypt every message. If he doesn't work as a proxy, can we decrypt? No, because he doesn't know what he doesn't know the cipher keys that the server and the client will use, right? So he cannot decrypt the traffic. That's why he will work as a proxy. And how does this work? We enable SSL decryption, and the client will send the client hello. The firewall will intercept the client hello, and he will send the client hello for this client. So a new client hello, he will forge, let's say forge the client, the real client hello, and he will send the client hello instead of a client. So he will work as a proxy device. The server will send the server certificate with a public key on all the information, and we'll do the SSL connection with the firewall. So see, we don't have an SSL connection between the client and the server. We have an SSL connection with the firewall and the server. And here they use a ciphering or a cipher key that they negotiated, and the firewall knows the cipher key because the SSL connection is between the server and the firewall. Then the firewall will take the server hello, a server certificate, will forge it, will take only some parameters from there, and will reissue a fake server certificate, and will send it to the client. And then he will build up a SSL connection with the client. Right? And at the end, we will have two SSL connections, right? SSL connection between the firewall and the server, and an SSL connection between the firewall and the client. A normal, if you don't use decryption, the normal SSL connection will be between the client and the server. Only the client and the server knows to decrypt the messages that are exchanged between them, and nobody can decrypt them. But here the firewall works as a proxy, right? And basically here is the point where all the messages are decrypted, right? So all the messages are decrypted. The firewall can decrypt the GET message and extract the URL information from the GET message because he knows the keys, right? He knows the ciphering between the client and the firewall because the SSL connection is between, and he will check if this the connection to that URL should be allowed or not, right? So this is how our server hello in step three different from server hello in step six. The server hello is different, and also the most important part is that the certificate is different because the firewall will reissue a certificate. So he will not send the server the original server certificate. He will make a fake, let's say a forged, and I will show you the next slide. What information does he takes from the real certificate? And what is the information that he will, let's say, forge? So yes, it's different. It's different. Some the certificate is different, and Also some parameters in the server hello, some are the same, some are different. Correct me if I'm wrong. The second method will use much more resources. It will mean more CPU and memory. Exactly. Now my question, will be the two methods get the same result? Yes, the we are right. SSL decryption will consume a lot of memory and resources. The delay will be higher because imagine everything is decrypted. Every packet will be decrypted by the firewall. So the client will send an encrypted packet to the firewall. The firewall decrypts it, it will inspect it, and then encrypt it again to the server. So he will decrypt, encrypt every message. Every message that will go to the firewall will be decrypted and encrypted. So of course it will use, it's an additional delay, and also it will consume a lot of memory. The second downside is that some application will not accept that fake certificate. Some application, I give you an example, Windows Update. When you do Windows Update, application, the Windows Update will try to connect to some URL. If the firewall will decrypt that and forge the certificate, the update will not work because the Windows will detect that the issuer is not Microsoft. The Windows is so smart to check also the issuer of the certificate. When you visit a website, it doesn't matter who is the issuer of the certificate, but some application who use some URLs to get some information like update or patches will verify who issued that certificate. And for example, Windows Update will verify and will see, oh, this certificate from 0.6 is not issued by Microsoft. You cannot issue and sign a certificate by Microsoft. You cannot fake it like this. And it will Windows Update will not work. And there are a lot of applications that will not work. So you need to exempt them from the decryption. This method is very simple. It only inspects some messages. The delay is almost insignificant. It's very simple. To your question, if you want to do basic URL filtering, I will recommend the first method, and almost all the customers use the first method for this. They say maybe. I read somewhere that is not so accurate because basically you're not inspecting the HTTP GET, you're inspecting only the parameters in the client hello and some parameters in the server certificate. But my point of view, these are hard to fake. I mean, only if you are inside of enterprise and you want to fake something or to do damage, yes. Then if you really want to do damage and you are a hacker and you want to visit, I don't know, some resources on the internet that you set up and download something from there, some malware, yes, it can be fake. But for normal use, for the normal users that are legitimate users and don't want to do harm, I think this is the method to be used. Also a thing, if you use this method, I mentioned that there is a way to push a web page to the user where it says you cannot connect to this URL because this URL belongs to, I don't know, to pornographic category and your access to this URL is blocked. If you use this method, the first method, you will not be able to send this kind of information to the users. Why? Because we block the connection before you send the URL GET message, right? And we cannot reply to this GET message. We block the access to this URL in the phase where the SSL handshake is being established. So it's impossible for the URL to send something to the customer, a notification on the web page, right? It's impossible to do this. If you want to do this, you need to use SSL decryption, because like I mentioned, when using SSL decryption, you will all the traffic will be decrypted, and the inspection is done on the GET message. And of course, if this belongs to a URL that you want to block, you also can send the message back to the client. So this is a proxy. This is a very good example of a proxy device, like here. The client and the server are not in the direct connection, right? There is a device in the middle. We have a SSL connection between the proxy and the server, and between the server and the client. So the client is completely isolated from the server, and also the device is the one that not only is the one, the proxy, it will also do all kinds of filtering of the traffic, URL filtering, antivirus inspection, and so on. This is a good example of a proxy device. And I hope also this will answer your question. Okay. So how will the firewall reissue the certificate? So there are some fields that he needs to keep, and also some fields that he needs to replace. For this, in order to reissue a certificate, you need to use on the firewall SSL decryption certificate. Either you can use the firewall can work as a CA authority and can issue such an SSL decryption certificate, right? You can issue. But of course, if you are an enterprise and you already have an CA authority implemented in your enterprise, you can use for that, you can create an SSL certificate and upload it on the firewall, and it will work. But let's see what will the firewall take from the real certificate. So the version he will keep, the serial number he will keep, right? The signature algorithm, he will replace it with a signature algorithm of the SSL decryption certificate that we use. The issuer, replace it with the CN of the SSL decryption certificate. So why do we need to replace this? Because we cannot replace if the issuer is Google or Microsoft. We cannot issue a certificate and let the issuer to be Microsoft, because we cannot sign it, and we're not Microsoft, the CA authority of Microsoft, and sign it with a private key. So it's fake, and the client will know that it's fake. So we need to sign it with our private key. So the issuer will be not, if we visit a Microsoft web page, right? If you inspect the certificate, the issuer will be Microsoft. But when doing SSL decryption and we reissue the certificate, the issuer will be the CA authority that we use, the firewall itself, right? Or our own CA authority that we use in the enterprise. Then the replace the public key. Of course, we cannot use the public key of the real server. We will take the public key of the real server and replace it with our own public key, right? And of course the signature, because we need to sign the certificate. So we cannot, like I mentioned, we cannot issue a certificate and say we are Microsoft and sign it with our own key. We need to sign it, and we need to use our own private key to sign it. So this is how, these are the parameters that we will keep from the certificate, and also the parameters that we need to change. And like I mentioned, for Windows Update, the Windows Update will check and he will see the issuer is not Microsoft. So I will not, I will see as this certificate being fake, right? So I will not, I will deny, deny it or reject it. So some applications will recognize that the issuer is not the issuer that they expect and will not work. So this is another, like I mentioned, this is another, let's say, weak point of this SSL decryption. Okay, so this is it for the principles. Now let's go to the configuration part and show you exactly how this works. So the roadmap is like this: configure the basic parameters, configure user-defined categories if we need, configure a URL filtering profile, then configure a security policy to match the traffic that you want to apply the URL filtering on, and then commit. And now let's get on the USG firewall and show you exactly how to do this, because I think this is the best way to understand it, not from slides. I hope you can see my screen.
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, so I connected to the USG firewall. First of all, I can't remember if I had some slides about this. For the URL filtering, first of all, what you need the license. You can do URL filtering based on whitelist and blacklist and based on user defined categories. So you can do the categories by yourself, but if you don't have a license, you will not be able to connect to the URL category server. So again, without license, you can use blacklist and whitelist and user-defined categories when you can build your own categories, but without license, you don't have that live feature where the firewall will check live to which category any given URL belongs to. Let's say go to the license management. And this is the group that you need to have, is the URL remote query. See, this is the license that we need to have. Another thing for SSL decryption, is there an online lab platform for working with the USG firewalls? Yes, it's the platform can be, but not for only for Huawei employees, as I remember. Only the Huawei employees can connect to the platform. I don't know if any Huawei employee or only the TAC employees, but to this online lab, only the Huawei employees can connect. So if you're not a Huawei employee, you cannot connect to this platform. So, like I mentioned, so URL remote query needs to be the license that you need. And if you want to use SSL decryption, you need to have also the content security feature, content security group feature license on the license. So again, URL remote query to use the remote query server, SSL decryption, you need to have extra the content security group feature on the firewall. Then you go to the update center and here are the signatures. Here I want to show you the malicious domain name signature database. This will be updated automatically. It's not updated because the firewall is not connected to the internet, right? And all the other signatures. And if you go here, another thing, after you buy the license, you need to download this component, URL remote QWERTY component package on the USG. Without this component, you will don't have the options to configure, and now it's not loaded on the firewall, so I cannot show you, but it's not something complicated. Without this component, you will not be able to connect to the remote query server, even if you have the license. So you need to go on the sec.huawei.com web page, our security portal, and download the component which is compatible with the USG version that you have on the firewall. After you have these, you can do anything on the firewall. So let's do some thing. Let me write down something that you want to establish. Let's make a problem. First, let's say we want we should make it more complicated so you understand. So first, we want to apply security policy to the R&D, all the users that belong to the R&D department. So apply URL. Let's write it down. Sorry, I was on the other screen. So apply URL filtering for the R&D department. They should be able to connect only to the technology websites. They can connect only to technology websites. Okay. We should whitelist www.yahoo.com. Okay. And we should make a user defined category. Is called, let's say, I don't know, relaxation or common websites. And in this category, we put www.game.com. Okay, so I think we have everything here. Okay, let's start it. So we want to apply the URL filtering on the R&D department. Now I show you something more that only configuring URL filtering. First, we need to have some users and to somehow identify which users belong to the R&D department. There we go to, we have a domain. We will not create another domain because now we don't talk about users. We don't talk about this feature. And in this domain, let's say we create a group, add a security group, and we call it R&D. R&D, name of the security group, and we put user one local in this group, right? We R&D. We have a security group called R&D. Now we want to somehow authenticate the users that belong to this group. For this, the best method, but this is another topic for another time, we can use, for example, the most dynamic and agile way is, for example, to use ADSSO, because most of the enterprises use the AD server. So what does ADSSO mean? We import all the users from the AD, right? From the Active Directory. We implement ADSSO. We install a plugin on the AD server. And every time a user from the enterprise will connect or will authenticate in the domain, the AD server will transmit this information to the firewall, and we will have this user online on the firewall. And we'll know that the user belonging to the R&D is online and with this IP address, right? So it's quite simple. I explain the working mechanism in three words, but we can implement something like ADSSO for this. So, okay. So now we have the R&D users, and we add it to the R&D department, all the users that belong to this. Now I mentioned that we have to make a security policy, right, that will match to these users, right? Because after the security policy, we need to make a URL profile. Okay, and we will make a security policy. Name, let's say R&D access to internet. Okay, source zone. In what source zone are the R&D? Let's say in the trust zone. The destination zone, the internet, usually is pushed in the untrust zone. And what we need to match also on service application, let's know. Yes, Huawei TACAS can configure and on the USG, right? And let's say what I wanted to, the user, R&D, and I put, right? Here we will configure the URL filtering profile. But see, so everyone that connects from trust to untrust, I will make it simple. I will not discuss about the security policies. So every traffic that goes from untrust from trust to untrust, and the users are belonging to R&D security groups, should be permitted. We will put it up on the top to be make it more simple. Move to top. We have the security policy, right? And now, because this traffic is permitted, right? We need to make a URL profile. Another problem what we need to do is to make a user defined category named common websites. Okay, let's see if I remember where to make the user defined category, URL categories. Here we have all the categories that are on the firewall. These are the predefined categories. See, ebooks, humanity, sports, social focus, military, and so on, right? And here, in the predefined categories, another thing, you cannot check or you cannot download this database from the firewall and see and have all the these categories from the firewall. What you can do, you can check here if some URL belongs to a predefined category. And let's make a test. www.google.com. See, it's already on the firewall. Google.com belongs to search engine and portals. Let's see Huawei.com. So in case someone wants to go on Google.com, Google.com is already on the local database in the search engine category, right? Let's see Huawei.com. Huawei.com belongs to network and communication, right? Information technology to network subcategory network and communication is already on the firewall. But if I take a random one, I don't know now. Game.com, let's see game.com, because I'm sure there is a website called game.com. See, no category. It belongs to no category. So game.com is not known to the firewall right now. But if you visit game.com, the firewall will connect to the remote category server, will take the information about the game.com, and will populate this predefined category. It will put it in the predefined category. I think now everyone has understood about the predefined categories. Okay, these are the predefined categories. And if I put add, I make a user defined category. It's very simple. If I make a category, it's a user defined category because I made it. The predefined categories are already existing on the firewall. And I say it should be called, common website. Common web sites, it's called common website. And here I can put URLs, right? I said game.com should belong to this. So I put host www.game.com. And now game.com belongs to the common websites. Okay, we have the user defined categories. And in the user defined categories, we have the, let's say, subcategory common websites. And in the common websites, we have game.com. Now, my question again, I don't need you to answer. If we have game.com to the user defined category and game.com in the gaming predefined category, and in the user defined category, it will be allowed. And the action for the predefined category for the gaming category is to deny. Will I be able to connect to the gaming, to www.game.com or not? The answer, I will not let you answer. The answer is yes. You remember? The highest, the most important is the whitelist, blacklist, then user-defined category. So if the action is allow and the URL is in the user-defined category, but the same URL is in the predefined category with the action block, the URL will be allowed. Exactly. Order to user before the predefined. Exactly. This is the answer. Okay, so we made the user defined category. Okay, now we have the go back to the policy. And we have the security policy, and then we make a go to the content security where you can make the antivirus profile, file blocking profile, data filtering profile, and so on. We will not talk about this because today the topic is only about URL filtering. And we need to create a profile and add URL filtering profile. Let's make it one from the beginning. And it's quite simple. We make a profile. It's called, let's say we make it R&D URL filtering. We can put a description, filtering websites for R&D department, okay. And see here, filter encrypted traffic. This, if you put this yes, it will do the filtering based on the first method. You remember the face method, based on inspecting the client hello and the certificate, the easy method of filtering HTTP. In order to let the firewall do this method and try to filter also the HTTP traffic, you need to click here, enable filter encrypted traffic. Then, we will do this because we want to do this. Then the action mode is the strict or lenient. What is this? A URL can belong to do to two categories. So gaming predefined categories. I'm talking about the predefined. So I will give you an example. Huawei.com can belong to technology, but can also belong to, I don't know, to IT or something like this. I invented a new category. You can put the action on one category on block and the action on one category to permit. If you put strict here, it will take the more severe action, so block. If you put here lenient, then it will do the more soft action. This means allow the traffic. So this is in case a URL belongs to two categories. Then we have the default action. What should the firewall or this profile do if he doesn't know to which category the URL belongs to? Let's say we cannot connect to the URL category server and we cannot find the URL category on our database, local database. What should we do? Should we allow to connect to this URL or should we not allow? And you can put allow or deny or block. Actually, there are three actions. Allow with allow. Alert will allow, but will create a log, alerting you that the traffic, it's allowed, but I alerted you, right? And the block will block the access to this URL. That malicious URL detection, you can put this enable function. It's exactly what I mentioned. It will check this signature with malicious URLs. And if the URL will belong to a URL from this signature database, it will block the access to this URL, right? And then we have the whitelist and the blacklist, right? And we say we want to we want to whitelist yahoo.com. So we want to whitelist yahoo.com. We go to the whitelist and put Yahoo, www.yahoo.com to the whitelist. If I let it like this, what is this? This is a perfect match, let's say like this, and will only filter yahoo.com. But actually, who wants to do this? Probably you want to we want to allow access to any domain or anything from this domain. So the best way to do it, it would be to put like this, use suffix, or like this, because we can have something before Yahoo, right? Or something like this. So it's good to be, we can do like this. So we whitelisted yahoo.com. What is the difference between host and URL? On host, it will match on the domain names, like yahoo.com. If you want to match on the URL, for example, www.yahoo.com/mail, you need to put it here, right? Because this is the also, yeah. So domains are put in the host part. If you want to match on domains, are put here. If you want to put on URLs, are matched here, like here, yahoo.com/mail. If you want to filter like this, you put it here. If you want only on domain names, you can put it here. This is the difference between these two. Then you have the URL filtering level. What is the URL filtering level? Again, the firewall comes with some in URL. Yes, you put exact URL. URL filtering levels. What are the filtering levels? The firewall comes with some filtering levels. Here are the user-defined and the predefined categories, right? In the user-defined, we have common website that I created, but you can create a lot of other user-defined categories. And let's see, if I put on high, what will happen? It will block a lot of websites. It will block P2P. It will block social network. It will block lottery. It will block religion. If you put it on medium, see, P2P is not blocked. It will block only sexual content and vulgar and gruesome gambling, drugs, and malicious websites and weapons. And let's say if we put it on the low, it's even few websites. Actually, it will block only six categories. It will block drugs, malicious website, pornography, crime, hated speech, and cult. So these are some predefined restrictions level. But of course, you don't need to do the predefined. If you want, you can use it, but you can use user-defined. And in user-defined, you can modify it how you want. So there is no problem about this. I can let what I want, for some I can put alert, from some I can put block, for some I can use allow. So I can define my own, let's say, access rights. Let's say if I put on high, actually I can do like this. I can use user, because I say for R&D, we want only to allow technology websites. So for this requirement, we should be able to block everything. Actually, we want to allow also the user defined, because we want to allow them access to games.com. And for user defined, we put alert, because anytime we want anyone from R&D will visit this URL, we want to have a log, right? And we want the technology. Let's say if we have some technology, I can't remember the name, sport, social network, job, search engines, vehicles, business, economics, malicious crime, weapons, suicide, hated others. So general websites, fraud, suicide, abortion, malicious drugs, gambling, food, business, economy, financials. Ah, here, information technology. We said that for information technology, we want to allow them. So we will put allow. Okay? And this is all. This is our URL filtering profile. And we put okay. So now we have, let's say, one guy from R&D will connect to, will try to go on the internet. It will match this security policy. We match the action of the security policy to permit. So traffic is permitted. After the traffic is permitted, the firewall will do all the content security checks that we configured in the security policy. Because the training is called URL filtering, we only configure the URL filtering profile, but you can put anyone you want. You can put also an antivirus profile and so on. Whatever content security you want to perform on that, that traffic. So we did all the requirements. So we applied the URL filtering for the R&D department. They can connect to the technology website. They can connect, we whitelisted yahoo.com and every URL that belongs to this domain. And we made the user-defined category called common websites. And we added the URL game.com to this website. And every time R&D employee will visit game.com, a log will be recorded on the firewall. So yeah, it's quite simple. It's not very complicated to configure. Let's say if we have time, I will not show or explain, or actually I will show you, even if it doesn't belong to this presentation, how to do the URL if you want to configure SSL decryption. If you want to configure SSL decryption, you go to the, let's say if I remember, where is it, to the objects. See, here is SSL decryption. Again, SSL, you will not see all this part if you don't have the content security license. First, you have to have this content security module upgraded on the, put on the firewall. And then you will need to have a license management, this content security group license, in order to be able to do this. If you don't have this license, you will not see these parameters here. SSL decryption certificate, these are the certificate. Like I mentioned, you need to create your own certificate, or if you have an CA authority, you can make a SSL decryption certificate using your CA authority and upload it on the firewall. And let's make a CA SSL decryption certificate. Click on generate. And here, you can, doesn't matter the certificate name, SSL decryption. You can put the email, the FQDN, country area, doesn't matter, the key type, RSA and key length. And here you can check it if it's trusted or untrusted. What it should be, trusted or untrusted. We will check it both. And I will explain you on fast forward what are these used for. Operation will overwrite the existing trusted and untrusted certificate. So you as you see, you can only have one SSL decryption certificate. We click OK. And the firewall is creating a new SSL decryption certificate. And we have it here. See, we can inspect it. We have all the data, and yeah, is a CA certificate authority. This is true. This means that it's a CA certificate, and you have all the data in here. This will be used for SSL decryption. You can download it here, export it, and import it in the browser. Now, my question to you. How does the firewall, how does the browser know? And I will try to explain this on fast forward because we don't have so much time. See here, when I connected to the firewall, it says that the connection is unsecure. But if I connect to google.com, see, the connection is secure. How does the browser know that the connection is secure when I go to google.com and when I connect to the firewall via HTTPS, because I'm connected to the eLab firewall. Here, see, the browser sees that as the connection is not secure. Do you know? I will explain it to you. Because we don't have time. Actually, the browser has a collection of CA certificates. Every browser comes with a collection of CA certificates. It has a CA certificate from Google, from all the main CA authorities on this world, from Google, from Microsoft, from, I don't know, everyone. So if I visit Google and I check the certificate, the issuer is this. See, GTS, probably is Google CA authority. So the browser has a CA certificate from this authority. This certificate is signed by this authority. See, here are the details. The certificate, so this is the chain. So the top root CA certificate is global sign. Then we have a secondary CA authority and a third CA authority. And then the third CA authority signed this certificate. So we have the chain of CA authorities. And here are the details. The public key, you can see it, the validity, and so on, right? And because the browser has a CA certificate from, I don't know, Global Sign or whatever, sees as this certificate as being authentic and says that the connection is real. If I go to the firewall, I connected through HTTPS to the firewall, the server certificate that the firewall uses is an issued by himself, because the firewall can, like I showed here, can also work as a CA authority. Does the browser have a CA certificate from the firewall? No, the firewall is a device. No CA authority issued something from this firewall. So the browser will get this message here that the connection is unsecure. how to make it secure? We have two ways. Either export the server certificate from the firewall, import it into the browser that you are using, and say to the browser, please trust this all the certificates that are issued by this authority. The second thing, it would be to go to the, I don't know, to Google or to other other authority, said, give me a server certificate, right? I will pay for it and I will upload it on the firewall, and then it will be secured. The connection will be secured. Okay. If we don't, now I will, yeah. And this is all. Again, this why I say it's more complicated to use SSL decryption. And I think we will have time, I will explain it because this is very interesting. Okay, like I showed you, the firewall works, the browser knows that, one second, where is the SSL decryption? This is very interesting part. Okay, here. How does the, if the client will visit google.com, right? Google, let's say we don't have an SSL decryption, we have don't have proxy. Google server will send a Google certificate to the client. The connection is secured, right? Here we have a proxy. The connection is secured because the browser that the client is using has a Google CA certificate and will verify the server certificate that is issued by this server. But here, does the firewall have all the CA certificates to check if this certificate is trusted or not? The answer is no, because the firewall doesn't have such certificate. For him, he cannot tell if you visit a website that is, see here, the connection is between the firewall and the server. If the server has a certificate issued by Google, or if the server has a certificate issued by himself, which is not trustworthy, the firewall doesn't know because he cannot compare. He knows, he can see the issuer, but he has not any CA certificates loaded on the firewall to check if these are trusted or not. I made this to be possible for some customer. It's very complicated. Actually, what you need to do, but it's complicated because the firewall doesn't have, but I think now the, I didn't work on the new versions, but I think now the new versions with the new firewall come with such a collection of CA certificates from the most important CA authorities. But on this version and on the version that I worked then, there was not such a collection. And how I solved the issue? I told customer, what browser are you using? I don't know, Google Chrome. Go on Google Chrome, export all the certificates that Google Chrome has in his collection, and import all the certificates on the firewall. So he exported everything that he has in Google Chrome, he imported everything in firewall, and then the firewall had the capability to compare every server certificate that he was receiving. Is this trusted or not? And then I told him, create two certificates, one trusted and one untrusted. And if you create one trusted and one trusted, what will the firewall do? He will receive first a certificate, he will compare it with his database and see, this is the trusted certificate. Okay, then he will use this SSL decryption certificate to do the decryption. If the client will, if the firewall as a proxy will receive a certificate from which he doesn't have a copy in his database, he will send to the end customer the untrusted SSL decryption certificate. And on the customer side, we will only trust export the trusted one and trust only the trusted one. In this way, even if the firewall will work as a proxy, the client will have same as I. If you go on the trusted website, he will see here the connection is secure. If he'll connect to the untrusted website, he will see that the connection is unsecure, like here. So it's a little bit complicated. I don't know, like I mentioned, I don't know for the new firewalls. If I remember, I read a little bit and the new firewalls come with some predefined or preloaded CA certificates, but this firewall and the old ones, it was a, let's say, a very difficult task to make it work perfectly, this SSL decryption. That's why, from my point of view, it's not recommended if you only want to do in your enterprise to do URL filtering, then it's better to use the first method. Okay, this is about SSL decryption. Let's go a little bit on the fast forward because we are a little bit behind, but it was nice to explain. From current slide, so let's go to the troubleshooting part. On the troubleshooting part, it's not such hard. Basically, we have the roadmap where the URL, the first one, when the URL is not filtered, let's say not blocked or was allowed, the user or user group is not applied in the security policy or is incorrectly applied. Like I mentioned, we made this policy, right? But if we forgot to put in that policy R&D department, it will not match, right? And then not matching the security policy, it will also not match to the URL filtering profile that we configured. Then the traffic matches the security policy rule with a higher priority. We need to take into account that security policies are matched from top to bottom, right? In our example, I've put the security policy at the top, but maybe I don't want to put it at the top. If we have another security policy that allows this kind of traffic, maybe someone made a security policy like we do and say, allow all the HTTP traffic for the R&D department. And this security policy traffic is before the policy that we did with URL filtering. Of course, it will allow the traffic and the traffic will not reach our security policy. The URL filtering profile is not applied to security policy. We forgot to do this. This is very simple. And the modified URL filtering profile is not submitted for the compilation. This is again something you need to take into account. I show you. The only, when you do some configuration on the firewall, you have here the commit button. The commit button needs to be pressed only when you do changes for the this part, for the content security. So this is the only time you need to commit the configuration. If you make some changes to the content security part, you make a URL filtering profile or an antivirus profile. Every time you do a change in the content security part, you need to commit the change. And this is the only part of the configuration that needs to be committed on the firewall. For any other configuration, like IPs, like security policies, committing is not necessary. But the firewall will prompt you. A pop-up will show here that you need to commit if you make some changes on that part. So maybe this is an issue. You forgot to compile the configuration and then analyze the exceptions. You can also analyze the exceptions. I don't know, you can put some statistics or something like this and make deeper troubleshooting. We will not talk about this. What is the roadmap when you have, you cannot connect to the remote because there were issues, a lot of issues that customers have the license. but they cannot connect to the remote query server. The first thing to do is, like I mentioned, check the license and the component that is uploaded on the firewall, and the license is valid. Then check the country code is configured. When you make this configuration, you need to configure a country code on the firewall. It's very simple to configure. I cannot show you this because the component is not loaded, I showed you, but it's very simple. There is a field there, you put the country to which you belong. Then check when the link between the device and the upgrade center website is normal. What you need to do, just go on the firewall and ping sec.huawei.com. This is the easiest way to do it. You see, does the DNS server work? Does the ping work? If it's okay, you get further. Check whether the security policy blocks local packages. I don't want to speak now about this, but when the firewall will connect to the content security, when the firewall will connect to the category server, there are three steps. What are the steps? The first connection, firewall will do three connections. The first connection is to sec.huawei.com to verify that the firewall has a license that is valid. So the first connection is the firewall will connect to the sec.huawei.com center. And if the license is valid, the sec.huawei home server will give an okay to the firewall and will give the IP addresses of some servers, depending on the country on which the user belongs to. Then the firewall will connect to these servers based on the country. For example, if you belong to Europe, the servers are in Germany, and all these servers then will give the IP address of the remote category server. So it's a three-way process to connect to the server. If it still doesn't work, so you need to check that all three connections are okay. You have also a troubleshooting button there on the firewall. So it will tell you, in the first version there was not such a troubleshooting button, and then you had to know exactly these steps. But now the firewall will do will try to connect to these servers and will exactly tell you on which step it cannot connect. And then the first thing you need to do if you have such an issue is to say, if you check the security policy, that it allows the connection from the local zone, the firewall itself, to the untrust or whatever, how the security policy is made. If it still doesn't work, then of course obtain the ESN of the device, the device name, and send an email to either contact talk or send an email to the on the sec.huawei.com website to verify if something is wrong with your the ESN of your device or something like this. And query the device status on the upgrade website. I don't know exactly what this means. I didn't visit the website for a long time. Probably based on your ESN number, you can query the status of your device. Probably something like this. But actually, I don't know this. I need to check this because I didn't visit it the security website for a long time. Because like I mentioned, I didn't work on tickets and with customer and was not needed. Okay, let's do a troubleshooting case, a fast one. After we have the users are in the trust zone, we have the untrust zone. After URL filter is configured, access to a normal URL is blocked. Symptom: the administrator has added URL to the predefined category, and configure the control action to permit. However, the user failed to access the URL. This is the networking information. It's quite simple. So the administrator, the engineer, put the URL in the predefined category, put the action on alert or allow, but the users can still not connect to the web server. Step one, go to monitor, to logs, and check the URL logs. Check, this is the simplest way to do it. Check if the connection to that URL was blocked by the firewall, it's clearly that we have a log, right? If we put the alert on block. If some other step blocked it. And the possible causes are, URL is added in the blacklist. Why? Because the blacklist has a higher precedence over the user defined. The URL is added to a user defined category and the action is blocked. So maybe it's added in the other category and in that category, the action is blocked. And we choose there the action if the URL belongs to two categories to be blocked, to make the stronger action, let's say like this. The URL page contains viruses and it's malicious. We click there to check for malicious URLs. The user connected to this website, but the firewall has also an antivirus profile configured. It will scan the traffic. It will detect traffic. And of course, it is putting that URL in the malicious site. But if the traffic was blocked, you will see the reason in the log. If there are no logs displayed, and this is harder then you need to check the configuration step by step. The user or user group is not applied in the security policy. Like I mentioned before, the traffic matches the security policy rule with a higher priority. The URL filtering profile is not applied to security policy. The modified URL filtering profile is not submitted for compilation. Exactly the steps that we discussed before. So here, if you don't have any logs, you need to take it step by step and check every step that is correct, that is correctly configured. Okay, now let's go to the FAQs. For the FAQs, we have, these are actually the most commonly asked question by the customer. How can I select the HTTPS encrypted traffic configuration? I mentioned, you just click the button there. I also explained you how it works. And like I mentioned, you can do it in two ways, either by inspecting the client hello and server certificate, which is the best way to do it because it has no delay. You cannot, don't need to configure anything, just make a click there and it's in real time. And the second, use SSL decryption for the inspection of the traffic. Then the firewall will check the HTTP GET message exactly, and it will work exactly like for HTTP websites, for HTTP traffic. But this has the downside that will consume a lot of resources. You will have a lot of problems with some applications and so on. So, like I mentioned, I'm not recommended only if it's mandatory to use SSL decryption. I don't know, you have high security requirements or something like this. What are the differences between application control and URL filtering to block HTTP websites? Application control is performed based on application to which HTTPS web pages belong. Application control does not involve SSL decryption. URL filtering is performed based on URL corresponding to an HTTPS web pages. To use URL filtering to control HTTP web pages, configure SSL decryption or run HTTPS filter enable command to configure HTTP traffic and traffic filtering. So HTTP filter enable is exactly, if you don't want to click there to enable it, you can go on CLI and run this command, is the same thing. So basically what it says here, HTTPS is an application. You can block or allow traffic that also uses HTTPS, but if you want to block URLs based on the basically URLs based on whitelist, blacklist, predefined categories, you need to use URL filtering. If you don't want, example, to use to block all applications that use HTTPS as a protocol, you just put there in the security policy at the application HTTPS, and it will block all the applications that use HTTPS. But remember, the application part is configured in the security policy, not in the content security. So if you block everything that uses HTTPS, it will block, you cannot surf any web pages because the security will block everything. So you will not get to the part where the URL filtering is done, right? But you can do something like this. You can, let's say we want to create only a security policy that will match on HTTP and HTTPS traffic. In the application part, you mentioned there, the security policy traffic should match to HTTP and HTTPS traffic, but you also want to do URL filtering. Then in the URL filtering profile, you do your own filtering. So it's good also like this. So we can put in the application part there when you created the security policy, besides the user group R&D, we could have put also their application HTTPS. It would be just as good. So we make more precise that security policy. And the third is any license required for the use of the URL filtering? If no license is purchased, user can use the URL filtering blacklist, whitelist function, user defined URL categories and predefined URL categories based on the local present URL categories database. To use the remote URL query function, you need to purchase the remote URL query license. The size of the local predefined URL category database depends on the device model. For details about the size of predefined URL category database, see the product manual. When SSL proxy is enabled to filter HTTPS encrypted traffic, you need to purchase the content security group license. So like I mentioned, without license, blacklist, whitelist, predefined categories, and user-defined categories, and predefined if we are already on the firewall. You cannot connect live on the category server to be live updated with the categories. So these are the FAQs. Another one. Why cannot be information pass push page be sent when URL filtering is configured to block the URL request from HTTPS? I already explained this. You can push information only if the firewall works as a proxy and intercepts the HTTP GET message, because you cannot push information to a customer if the customer didn't started the HTTP communication. The push page is only possible to push to the client only if the client already sent the HTTP GET message. When you enable HTTPS filtering, like I explained to you, we filter based on the client hello and server hello and server certificate. So it's impossible for the firewall to push a notification from the customer to the customer, because customer didn't even reach the point where he sends the HTTP GET message. He reached the point where the SSL handshake takes place and he wants to do a SSL tunnel with the server. So these are all. This a little bit about the Huawei Enterprise Community for support community.
Yeah, I will just quickly go through these two slides. For those of you who are not familiar with the community already, I recognize some of you. I know you are familiar and members of the community. I just want to make a short overview. This is the official technical community for all Huawei Enterprise products, solutions, and certifications. We already have over 200,000 members, but our community keeps growing every day. We are proud to have members from different parts of the world, from all over the world, actually. Here you can find an extensive knowledge base with over 50,000 posts to learn from. You can find solutions, different cases, different configuration examples, troubleshooting cases, documentation, and so on. At the moment, we have an average solving time under 24 hours. Sometimes it can be even less, so you might get a solution in just a few hours. And we have also created a public recognition and reward system for the most active members of our community. At the moment, we have the Elite Users Program, where we invite our users to become to have more important roles in the community and contribute more for different types of rewards. We will also launch the Hall of Fame, which will basically display the most active members of the community. We also have the high coins, which are the internal currency of the community, which you can use in exchange of the gifts that we have in the online shop. As you can see, we have monthly webinars and different activities, more technical activities, but more non-technical activities as well. We want our community members to learn and to share their knowledge, but also to have some fun and interact with their peers in the community. So we invite you to take part in different activities, and you have a chance to get different types of rewards. Catalin, if you can go to the next slide.
Yes, I will go to the next slide, but I have a question here. Just I will do a Huawei TACAX can work in the USG firewall. Can you explain?
Yeah.
It doesn't work in the USG firewall. You need to have a Huawei TACAX. It can communicate with Huawei TACAX. One second. Even if this should belong to another topic, I will show you here what are the, I think this will answer your question. You go to the object and you go to the authentication server, see here. And you can see here what servers are, can the firewall interact with. We have Radius, we have Huawei TACAX, we have AD, we have LDAP and TSM, right? So if you use Huawei TACAX for users authentication in the enterprise, let's say the most common is AD. If you have AD, you make a AD template where you put the server name, the LDAP port, and so on. All the configuration that is needed to make the communication possible with the AD server. For Huawei TACAX is the same. You go on Huawei TACAX and you define it, the name of the server. I don't know. Server. And then you put primary authentication server IP of the server and what port is used. Secondary authentication IP of the server. Then the shared key for Huawei TACAX, which is, I don't know, Catalin. Then we go to advanced settings, source IP address. Which do you want to be the source IP address, which the firewall will use when he connects to the Huawei TACAX server, 1.1.1.1, reply timeout, and so on. Then you could put, primary authentication server. It's not okay. Sorry, needs to be an IP address. It's 10.10.10.10 with port, I don't know. 8.8, right? And I created the Huawei TACAX server template, right? In this moment, the USG firewall can interact with the Huawei TACAX server and use the Huawei TACAX server for user authentication. Either if it's another thing, you can go and test the template, right? After the template is okay to see if the authentication is correct. Let's say I have an account on TACAX, Catalin. I go Catalin with IP, with the password Catalin, and I do the test. And the firewall will it's account test timeout because we don't have this. Basically, the firewall will try to authenticate via Huawei TACAX, Catalin on the server. And then we can use the server for in the domain for a lot of things. We can use this, we can use the Huawei TACAX authentication for SSL VPN access, for L2TP over IPsec, for IPsec access, for administration access, for online behavior management. It's exactly what I mentioned. In the moment the user will go online and authenticate to the Huawei TACAX, the Huawei TACAX will communicate to the with the server, and the user will be also online on the server, on the firewall. So I think this explains your question. But yeah, this topic belongs more to the user authentication, and yes. Maybe we can do sometimes another topic about this and talk about the user authentication methods on the USG firewall. Okay, I hope it explained your question. And now my question.
Before you go to the questions, I would just like to present the forum post. Yes. This is the forum post where I invite you to go and reply Catalin's question. I will leave the link here in the chat. So please, if you already have an account, just log in. If you don't have an account, please create a new account and then you can go to this post and answer the three questions. After you'll see the questions here, I will also update this post and I will add the questions there as well. And you just have to leave a comment under the post and answer there for a chance to win a gift card. So this is the link. If you want to participate in the Q&A session, I invite you to go here. And now Catalin will present the three questions and we will end this session.
Okay, so the questions are the following. Which statements are true about URL filtering license? These are multiple answers. So A, if no license is purchased, user can use the URL filtering blacklist and whitelist function. User defined URL categories and predefined URL categories based on the local present URL category database. B, to use the remote URL query function, you need to purchase the remote URL query function license. C, enable SSL proxy to filter HTTPS encrypted traffic, doesn't require any license. So these are multiple answers, and please write the answers, the good ones, so which are true. Okay, I will go to the next one. Question two, if the following URL, www.huawei.com, asterisk is added to the whitelist, but also to the blacklist, which will be, will the access be permitted or denied? So we put the same URL also in the blacklist, but also in the whitelist. A, traffic to this URL will be denied. B, traffic to this URL will be permitted. So both in whitelist and in blacklist. Okay, and the third question is, if you use the exact matching rule, so no asterisk, so on the exact match in the blacklist for the URL, www.game.com, which URLs will be blocked? A, www.game.com, B, www.game.com/tech, C, www.game.ro. So, yeah, these are my questions. Thank you for joining the presentation. It was a pleasure to make this presentation. Sorry, it took a little bit too long. Yeah, and I spoke a little bit. I spoke a lot because I feel my throat is big. This throat is sore already. But thank you for joining. I hope, yeah, if you work with firewalls or you have the opportunity to work, this clarified a little bit about the URL filtering. I'm sure all, also, even if you don't work on Huawei firewalls, the concept is more or less the same, also for the other vendors, how it works. And yeah, I hope this presentation will be really useful in your daily work on your future, I don't know, project. Thank you a lot, guys. And yeah, we'll keep in touch on the forum.
And thank you guys. It was a great session. Have a nice day. Thank you all for joining.
Bye-bye.
Bye all. Have a good day.